thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. This is my first time in George Mason, and I really like the area. I have 150 slides, so I better get going quickly. it's a challenge, but I want to talk to you a lot about many of the exciting things that are going on in our lab and in this area. So let me just dive right in, okay? So the title of the talk is Internet of Acoustic Things. And let me motivate this a little bit. Okay, so you know these voice assistants such as Amazon Echo, Google Home, Apple HomePod, these kind of devices are percolating rapidly into our homes today, right? 50 million voice assistants have already been sold in a very short period of time, and the projections are staggering, right? All cars would have voice assistants. The thermostats would be able to speak, right? It's like your Star Wars dream where you just talk, right? And people and these computers, machines, the smart environments would respond to it, right? But you know, this is only the tip of the iceberg, okay? The future is actually bringing a whole variety of acoustic technologies and capabilities, right? Focused around sensing, analyzing, understanding, and playing with acoustic sounds, vibrations, all kinds of acoustic signals, okay? Just let me give you a few examples. Qualcomm has come up with is coming up with these new kinds of earbuds that would not only do music streaming, but would do noise cancellation, NLP, and all kinds of other machine learning on the earbud itself. I mean, they're bringing in neural network processing on the chips that will be in your earbuds. So in some sense, you say, hey, Alexa, or hey, Siri, do this for me, and your earbud starts interpreting those commands and actually gives you responses. Qualcomm is trying to come up with these earbuds, and Neura is another startup that's also kind of coming up with these next generation earable devices, earable meaning wearables that are around the ear. And what they're trying to do is they're trying to shine a wire, an acoustic signal into your ear canal, look at the responses, look at the reflections of those signals, and anatomically model the shape of your ear canal, and then modify the sound from the speakers of your earbud to exactly suit your frequency response, right? So you hear the sound the way you hear it best, and they want to automatically figure these things out, okay? Google and Leap Motion, these kind of companies are into gesture recognition with acoustics, meaning that if you have wearing a smart watch, they're shining signals from the watch, and you do different gestures with your hand, and by looking at the reflections of these acoustic signals from your fingers, they're able to figure out what you're trying to do. So you can change the time of your watch by doing finger gestures like that, and by looking at the reflections, they know, ah, this is a finger gesture that's trying to change the time, and they actually change it, okay? The medical industry is not behind either. Johnson & Johnson has come up with this patch that you wear on your body, and the patch actually listens to body sounds and vibrations, and that actually enables new kinds of biomarkers that were unprecedented in the past. Essentially, the body makes different kinds of acoustics and vibrations that are very much relevant in diagnosis and all kinds of other mobile analytics. Finally, my favorite is this startup from MIT, which is kind of doing extremely directional speakers. Meaning, if you have kids at home, you'll realize that you can never watch TV while they're around. But in this kind of a setting, the TV can actually beamform just towards you so that everyone around the TV, they don't hear the TV at all. Only you hear it because the TV is exactly beamforming around your ears. And this is not easy. There is a lot of work in beamforming technology, but it's not easy. In this case, they're actually exploiting certain properties of the air, which actually makes these signals go in a specific direction. And the future in this is what is being called sound pockets, meaning there's going to be a speaker which is going to send sound. No one's going to hear it except someone on that chair, okay? So can you design such techniques where sound is only heard at certain locations and not anywhere else, okay? There's fantastic stuff happening. NSF had this hearables challenge. So if you're not looking at this area, this is something to look at because there's a wave coming in acoustics. Okay? Now, this kind of excitement is not at all surprising because this is essentially the confluence of sensing, computing, and communication, which originally started with the smartphone revolution, but is actually now starting to percolate at finer granularities, and acoustics being one of those granularities, right? I mean, this kind of sensing, computing, communication came to cameras, right? Now, cameras have become very mature. All kinds of artificial intelligence, all kinds of techniques have come into cameras, and now we are like moving to the next sensing dimension, which is acoustic, and this is kind of converging. And this convergence is enabling a new ecosystem that is being called the Internet of Acoustic Things, or at least we are trying to call this the Internet of Acoustic Things, okay? So today, this talk, I want to talk to you about a couple of primitives that we've been developing in our research group around acoustics. And these are not the conventional primitives that you hear about, but somewhat more researchy. If you ask me what is the application, I may not have a good answer, but these are like building blocks, Lego blocks that we are trying to build in acoustics and vibration, which might have various applications, which is an open-ended question. So in some sense, we are designing hammers, and how you use these hammers to build different systems is something that's still open. I want to talk to you about these primitives, these building blocks, or these hammers that we are developing in the lab. Please feel free to stop me and ask questions wherever it's not clear. I definitely don't want to be the only person talking in this room, okay? So I want to start with this topic called inaudible acoustics, and let's just dive in, okay? So, you know, normal sound is audible both to humans and to microphones, okay? Normal sound is below 24 kilohertz, right? And these are the signals that humans are able to hear, and microphones are designed like human ears that they can also hear these 24 kilohertz or sub 24 kilohertz sounds. Okay? Ultrasound, on the other hand, is greater than 25 kilohertz, and it's not audible to humans and neither audible to microphones, right? Because microphones are again designed for human applications, so they're not audible to either of them. We've designed sounds that are above 25 kilohertz, meaning they're ultrasound, which are not audible to humans, obviously, but are completely audible to any microphone without us having to do any software or hardware changes on that microphone. Meaning, I'm going to send out a sound that's above 25 kilohertz. Your microphone should not hear it. You should not hear it. You are not going to hear this sound, but your microphone is going to think it's a regular, normal sound below 24 kilohertz, and I'm not going to touch your microphone at all, okay? If you can do this, why do you care? Well, there are many possibilities or many reasons why you might care, but here is the most fun one. The most fun one is I can go near your house and send a signal, Alexa, open the garage door. You are not going to be able to hear it, but Alexa will hear it like it's a regular voice command and open the garage door for me. Now, if I'm not malicious, I would just say, Alexa, set up an alarm for 3 a.m., okay? If I'm playing a prank on you and the alarm will sound at 3 a.m., you are not going to be able to hear any of this, okay? Let me kind of quickly show you a demo of what this system looks like. So here it is. So this is my student asking a regular question to Alexa. Now we're going to ask the same question by creating our own signal that's coming out of the speaker.
The United States capital city is Washington, D.C.
And you didn't hear the question, right? But Alexa heard the question as if it's a regular voice command. Okay? Is the idea clear, or what we are trying to do clear? Now, this is a bad application of this capability, this inaudible acoustics capability, but there are good applications as well, such as if Trump doesn't want Cohen to record any conversation, President Trump could send out this inaudible jamming signal that would jam all spy microphones in the environment, Okay? So in a military kind of a setting, if I'm in a foreign enemy territory and I don't, and I'm worried about getting bugged, being bugged, or spy microphones, I can jam all spy microphones. I can have inaudible data communication. I could go to a museum and these paintings could send me information about each of these paintings, and my microphone on my phone will be able to hear it and show me all the information that I need to know, and that would be inaudible. So I can use the audible channel, which otherwise we use for human communication, for data communication as well, and yet it would not interfere with any of our regular lifestyle. Right? So there are various possibilities, and we are not the expert on coming up with the right application. We just want to enable this capability that I'm going to design inaudible sounds that are audible to unmodified microphones. Okay? Okay, so how do we do this? Okay. So to understand how, we need to kind of jump in a little bit into what microphones look like. Okay? But at a high level, what we really do is we try to exploit some hardware backdoor in microphones. Specifically, microphones have nonlinearity in them, and we design the signals in a way that will exploit that nonlinearity, and thereby the microphones would start hearing things that it's not supposed to. Okay? That's the high-level idea, but let me get into a little bit of the details. Okay? So here is the idea. A microphone is essentially a diaphragm. It's like a paper that vibrates when airwaves hit the paper. The output of the diaphragm is a voltage that gets amplified by an amplifier. I can assure you this is the most EE stuff that we'll talk about and nothing else after this. The amplifier gives you a stronger signal, right? And then the filter of the microphone eliminates everything outside around 25 kilohertz. And the filter says, oh, humans only understand things below 25 kilohertz. Why do I need the signal? Eliminate everything beyond 25 kilohertz. And then the analog to digital converter samples the signal, and you get digital output at your end. Okay? Now, if you look at this diaphragm and this amplifier, if you think about this, this is typically modeled as a linear system, meaning if I give an input Vin, voltage in, to this system, the output should be V out, where V out is an amplified version of V in. Okay? I speak, the diaphragm hears creates some voltage, and the amplifier out gives a magnified version of that voltage. So you can model this as V out equals A1 times V in, where A1 is the amplification gain. Clean? Okay? But this is only true in the linear regime of that device. Meaning, this is only true if Vin falls within 0 to 25 kilohertz. If you give this same device some signal that is at the higher frequency, the device no longer behaves like a linear straight line. Instead, it starts behaving like a curve, and the model of that curve has to be modeled with higher order terms, such as A2 V in square plus A3 V in cube, and so forth. Does that make sense? So if I give a higher frequency signal to the same device, it no longer behaves linearly. It starts showing these kind of nonlinearities. And this is very well known. Okay? Now, these higher order terms, the cube term is actually very weak. So you can ignore that. But this square term is actually not that weak. And that is where the opportunity would come from. This is the back door that we are trying to get inside a microphone. So let's look at what happens or how we can leverage this V in square. Okay? And observe that this nonlinearity is fundamental to all microphones. It's fundamental to all the hardwares because you have to have this diaphragm and this amplifier, and they exhibit nonlinearity always. Okay? If you throw money at the problem, if you spend a lot of money to create these components, your range of linearity might increase, but there'll always be a nonlinear range. Okay? Great. Okay? So let's see how we actually exploit this. Let's say we have a speaker which generates two signals, sine F1 plus sine F2. And F1 and F2 are all ultrasound, meaning they are very high frequencies. Okay? Now observe that the microphone filters out all this signal when it comes over here. That's what the microphone is supposed to do. But because these signals are in the higher frequencies, it will also trigger the nonlinearity of the microphone. Now, this Vin square, this Vin is F1 plus F2. These two signals will come into Vin square, and it will become sine F1 plus sine F2 whole square. Make sense? Right? The microphone, if you give the microphone a high frequencies, it's going to just square the whole signal. That's what nonlinearity is all about. Okay? So now if you do sine F1 plus sine F2 whole squared, it'll be sine square F1 sine square F2 plus 2 sine 1 F2 sine 2 F2. And if you actually write out the whole trigonometry, it's going to turn out cos 2 F1 cos 2 F2 cos F1 plus F2 cos F1 minus F2. If you write it out. You don't have to. I know you have to go back to your 10th grade, but just trust me on this one. Okay? Cos 2 F1 is nothing but a frequency which is double of 40, which is at 80. Cos 2 F2 is at 100 because it's double of F2. Okay? So all these frequencies are even higher frequency components. Okay? Except F1 minus F2, which actually, if you design F1 and F2 correctly, let's say 40 and 50, F1 minus F2 becomes 10 kilohertz, which actually gets recorded by the microphone. Microphone has no way of knowing whether this 10 kilohertz signal came as a direct over-the-air signal, or it came through the backdoor, nonlinear backdoor channel of the microphone. The ADC samples it and says, oh, I have a 10 kilohertz signal. This is the core opportunity, and all microphones have it. Okay? So it's as if you have used this F1, or you have shifted F1 into the microphone filter by using F2 as a helper frequency. And now it need not just be F1. If you give some other signal over here, all those signals would get shifted into the microphone's filter. So if I can synthesize a sound properly, which says, Alexa, open the garage door, I can shift that signal into the microphone's filter range and thereby make the microphone hear my voice command. Right? Or I can modulate the signal to have data over here, and the data bits would get shifted, and the microphone will hear it as if there is data coming in, like ones and zeros. Right? So there are various applications over here. You can jam spy microphones by, again, making this a jamming signal. And once you send this jamming signal over here, the microphone will completely get jammed because this is like an interfering signal from the outside. And of course, there is this one where we actually attack voice assistants like Amazon Echo. So when we started doing this, we were able to attack Echo very well, actually. Right? The only thing was we were doing it from nearby, near the Echo. Why? Because the Vin square, the A2 Vin square, that A2 is actually a small value. Okay? So if you want that Vin square to actually shift the signal, you need to have enough power. And you need to be close to the Amazon Echo to be able to have enough power. Okay? But really what we want, the attacker would really want to launch this attack from your neighborhood. You know, I drive my car to your residential neighborhood. I have a antenna or a speaker system, and I start saying, open your garage door, open your garage, Alexa, open your garage door. And whoever has Alexa, and has Alexa connected to IoT devices in the home would open the garage door for me, right? That's really what I want to do. So I want to be able to sit outside your house and make your Alexa do this for me, right? If I'm already inside my house, inside your house, and I can trigger Alexa, then you have a bigger problem. You cannot trust your friend, right? But this is the more realistic attack scenario, right? Not only that, there could be other attacks where someone can sit in a park and people wearing smart watches, people's phones being turned on for Alexa or OK Google or Siri, I can start making your phone download all kinds of malware. Right? I can make your phone do all kinds of things because more and more these devices are responding to voice commands. I can make your car drive to me if your car is going to listen to voice commands. Okay? So we wanted to do this over longer range. Okay? And that turned out tricky. Why? here is the problem. You know, speakers are the opposite of microphones, right? For example, if you're in the microphone, you have a diaphragm, then an amplifier, then filter, and so on. The speaker is really doing the opposite, where you have digital signals, then you have a digital to analog, then you have a filter, then you're amplifying, and then you're playing it by the speaker's paper, the diaphragm, vibrates, and that creates air signals. That is what you hear, right? So if there's nonlinearity in the microphone, there's nonlinearity in the speaker, right? Which means, when you send this signal through the speaker should also create that shift, and whatever comes out of the speaker should become audible. Make sense? Right? So here's the idea. Let's say I have a voice command, Alexa, open the garage door. Let's call it VT. I want to send this voice command, but I want to send it at a higher frequency. So I modulate the voice command by multiplying it with some frequency omega. Let's call it F1. And I move it to a higher frequency. This becomes inaudible to humans, right? If you're unfamiliar with this, just take it from me that you can move a free signal, VT, to a higher frequency by multiplying it with a carrier signal, which is sine F1T. You can move it to F1, okay? Now, when you play this signal through the speaker, this VIN, of course, this of course needs to be an ultrasonic speaker. So this VIN comes in directly as an output of the speaker, okay? But the speaker's VIN square, this is sine square omega 1t, which is 1 minus cos 2 omega 1t, which creates some component in the baseband, which is audible, and some component in the high frequency, which gets filtered away. All I want to say is, this high frequency signal, when it goes out through the speaker, if the speaker was completely linear, this should have been the output of the signal, of the speaker. But because of the nonlinearity of the speaker, you get a component that becomes audible. Because the speaker is also like a microphone. The nonlinear components are there as well. As a result, your speaker's output is becoming audible, then you've defeated the whole purpose. It's no longer an inaudible acoustic signal, right? You want to eliminate this acoustic portion, this audible portion, okay? So what can you do? And of course, this is general to all speakers, so you want to do something more fundamental, right? Now, it turns out that you cannot eliminate this signal. And this gets into a little bit more EE, which is you cannot really send a signal through the speaker that will cancel out this signal because the speaker's transfer function is difficult to estimate whenever it's heavily nonlinear. Forget all that. The high-level point is that the speaker leakage is unavoidable. So you have to somehow tame it. You have to somehow suppress it or do something, a hack with it. Okay? So here is the idea. You get the signal. The linear part of the speaker gives you exactly that signal, but the nonlinear part gives you another signal which becomes audible. And it turns out that the bandwidth of this high frequency ultrasound is the same as the bandwidth of this audible signal because it's getting self-convolved. Doesn't matter if that's not clear, but all you need to know is this bandwidth in frequency is the same as this audible bandwidth. Okay? And you have the high frequency value. Now, what we want to do, what we have been able to do, the idea to eliminate this part is the following, or we actually cannot eliminate to kind of make it less audible. This is what we are going to do. We're going to take a small portion of the bandwidth. That portion will go linearly. We are going to play that small portion of the bandwidth through a speaker. That's going to go out linear. And then we are going to have that same bandwidth become audible in the low frequency range. We are going to take another small chunk of the bandwidth, play it through another speaker. That's going to give me this signal. But that's going to also create an audible signal that sits on top of the original speaker. This is the core thing to understand. Okay? I'm going to take the whole signal, chop it up into different frequency bins, and play each of these bins through a different speaker. Why? Each speaker would make an audible component from zero to some hertz, but each of the speaker's outputs would go and sit on top of each other. So if I can make these frequency chops very, very small, then this part of the bandwidth will also become small. Right? Because we said that the leakage bandwidth is the same as what you're giving into the speaker. Right? So all we have done is we've taken all the leakages and we've piled them on top of each other, and the gain is, originally the leakage was this large when we were playing it through one speaker, but now the leakage is this much, which is much lower frequency. But there's more energy in this band. Okay? So now the question is, okay, this chopping compresses the leakage band, but I still do have leakage. This is still audible leakage because this is lower frequency, less than 24 kilohertz. So when I'm playing this sound, we are hearing shh coming out of the speaker. Hey, someone might say, where is that shh sound coming out? That's the attacker, right? So we don't want this, okay? But we cannot eliminate this either, okay? So here is the idea. So fortunately or unfortunately, okay, humans have a hearing curve. Okay? So imagine that this signal, we are zoomed in, this signal over here, the leakage signal is called LF. And that's the leakage, that's where the power is, and it's pretty low frequency. Turns out that humans do not hear low frequencies very well. Right? So if you go below, say, 500 hertz, right? You have to pump a lot of power for a human to hear below 500 hertz. Actually, these machines make a lot of noise, but many of these noises are in the lower frequencies, which we do not hear. So one possibility is, what if I could shape this signal, this leakage signal, in a way that remains under the audible human curve? Right? So I want to put more energy towards the lower frequencies and less energy on the higher frequencies so that the humans is not able to hear the leakage signal. Okay.
Are there any health implications of having a lot of these non-audible signals?
So lower frequencies is not a problem, right? Because nature itself has many low frequency components. The higher frequencies, there are issues. In fact, I don't know if you saw this news in Cuba. A lot of people in the American embassy all together started complaining about ear problems. And then there were some rumors that there were attacks from the ultrasound, which was directed to these human ears. And even this weekend, I was talking to a few people who are still trying to corroborate these things. So the implications of an ultrasound frequency with high power on human ears, I feel it's still an open question. It's a biological question. Okay, so that is possible. But the low frequency stuff is not a problem because there's low frequency signals all around in nature around us. Okay? So what I'm going to do, I can still keep telling you, okay, there it is. So all I need to do is take that LF signal and make it under the audible curve. What knobs do I have to turn? Well, if I chop the frequencies small, that LF signal squishes more and more towards the lower frequencies, right? But the energy goes up. So I can run an optimization function which will optimize this LF signal in a way that maximizes the minimum separation between LF and TF, which is the audible function, right? So I'm going to maximize the minimum value between LF and TF for certain chops of the frequency band. Okay? And once we do that, things become inaudible because this is under the human audibility curve. We have chopped the signals in the right way, in the optimal way. And then with the help of the helper function F2, we now make this signal move. So just to be clear, this is the output of the speaker. The speaker is sending out a high frequency sound the way we wanted, and the audible leakage of the speaker is inaudible because we designed the signal carefully to remain under the audibility curve. This high frequency signal now goes to the microphone, and because we are also sending an F2, this signal gets shifted into the microphone filter. So you have inaudible acoustics in the air, humans cannot hear, but inside the microphone, the signal gets completely shifted and the microphone hears it the way you want it to. Okay? So here is the speaker design that we have. We have a bunch of ultrasonic speakers, and you see that we need these many speakers because we are chopping that frequency band in small pieces so we all can squish the leakage into a small bandwidth. And now I can show you the demo where we have the speaker 25 feet away. Oops. Doesn't matter, actually. So all I was going to show is when the speaker is very far away, you can still launch the attack. And therefore, you can start seeing the possibility of standing outside a home and actually making contact with Alexa or any of these voice-enabled devices. That's a good question. We have not looked at that. Right now, we've just packed them together. But this is not beamforming, where we are not trying to estimate the channel and make the signals go in a way that they constructively interfere at the receiver. We just, because we are sending separate frequency bands, and because human voice is not too sensitive to phases, we do not care too much about the speaker design. Then it's a problem. Then it's a little bit of an issue. Yeah. Not too much of an issue, but it's a little bit of an issue.
Would the microphone be able to receive the
signal further away? No, the microphone might still be able to. If the speakers are far away, the phases of these signals would become more and more different, right? And when the phases of these individual signals are different, the microphone may not be able to decode that voice. So we want these speakers to be close by, but it's not a strict requirement, we believe. Okay, great. The last slide I want to say is this is true with all microphones. So you can make a video camera's microphone also hear these things. In fact, when we were video recording this, it was a major problem because our camera's microphone was also picking up the inaudible sound. Okay? So we had to go very far away from this system so that the signal doesn't travel all the way to the video camera's microphone, right? And then we zoomed in with a lens to kind of show the video. You see the point, right? Your video camera also has a microphone, so that should also pick up the inaudible voice command, right? So that's why we had to go far away and only zoom in the visual dimension with a lens, okay? So all these devices have microphones, and they all respond. How do you defend against these attacks? We have a partial solution in our recent paper, but that's a separate topic that I'm happy to chat about if you're interested. Okay. So high level, we've kind of built this building block, which is inaudible acoustics, and we think there are a variety of applications. Maybe the fun ones are the attack ones, but there are also potentially favorable, positive applications that we could build with this capability. Okay. I want to move on to the next one, completely switch gears. And I want to talk to you about network noise cancellation. Okay? This is something that we are very excited, and this is our recent work where we are trying to say, can we do better noise cancellation headphones? Okay? Let me jump in. Okay? Noise is everywhere, right? I don't know how many of you know this, but I have people talking in the corridor who actually affect my concentration a lot. I don't know if you face this as well. A lot of people tell me in these open cubicle kind of environments, it's actually painful to actually work. Call centers are similar, where people are always talking on the phone. It's very, very distractive. Construction outside your classroom, big problem. The lawnmower guy at 6 a.m. in the morning on a Saturday, you know, he or she might be very enthusiastic about mowing lawn. You may not be after a 3 a.m. deadline, right? And of course, the humdrum of city life. There's a lot of noise. In fact, people are saying that the noise pollution is increasing dramatically, and there's a lot of work happening how you can bring it down. Okay. What's the solution today? People tend to wear headphones, earphones, to kind of let the noise die down. What we want to do is the following. Okay. We want to either create these kind of headphones that do much better noise cancellation, or we want to do comparable noise cancellation as these headphones, but without blocking the human ear. Blocking the human ear is actually a big deal, because when you block the ear, air doesn't circulate into your ear, and that is not good for your health. Right? If you have something that is open, you might be able to wear it all the time. Okay? And you might be able to do other things on such kind of a hearable device. Okay? So we want to give you the knob to choose between one of these, and if you choose to do better form factor, we'll give you same noise cancellation. If you choose to do better noise cancellation, we can do this. Or we can make this device robotic, that something will come in and block your ear. That'll give you fantastic noise cancellation, or it'll open your ear. That'll give you comparable noise cancellation. Okay? And the way we are going to do this is by marrying wireless networking with noise cancellation. And let me tell you the key idea with an example. I hope this would be fun. Okay? Here's the idea. Okay, we call our system mute. Okay? Here's the idea. Let's say Alice is reading a book at her office desk, and someone's talking and disturbing Alice on the corridor. Okay? Alice takes a small IoT device, which has a microphone and a wireless transmitter, a small device, and puts it on her door, like this. Okay, why? Well, when this disturbing sound starts, it would hit this IoT device first. Okay, and this IoT device takes this sound and relays that over wireless towards Alice's ear device, right? The person says, hey, how are you doing? This device takes that sound, converts into digital bits, creates a wireless signal, and sends that wireless signal to Alice's headphone or earpiece. Alice's earpiece also has a wireless radio, gets that wireless signal, and pulls out the sound from that wireless signal. Okay? Here's the trick. Wireless radios or wireless signals travel a million times faster than sound, right? You see the lightning much before the thunder, right? And therefore, this ear device sees the sound or knows the sound that is going to come way late into the future. So I have all the time to play with the sound, create the anti-noise, do a much better noise cancellation. I have all the time while the actual sound is coming, taking its own sweet time to come to my ear device. So by the time the sound comes, I exactly know what that sound looks like. I can do all my signal processing, and together I can now create the anti-noise sound that will cancel very nicely at your ear. Does that make sense at a high level? Right? That's the idea. We call this look-ahead, meaning the difference in the propagation delays between wireless and sound is what gives me the advantage, the head start. And that is what I'm going to take advantage of. And this is analogous to seeing the lightning first and then covering your ears, because you know the sound is coming. This is exactly that. Okay? But we don't want to cover my ears, right? We don't want to cover our ears. We want to do something electronic. So here's the idea. Okay? So we leverage look ahead in three ways. One is wideband cancellation, non-causal filtering, and sound source profiling. Let me kind of quickly give you the intuitions for each of them. So wideband cancellation. If you don't understand anything from this talk, maybe the only takeaway is you kind of get to know what is happening inside a noise cancellation headphone. So let's look at what happens inside this $250, $300 headphone. Okay? Turns out, all these noise cancellation headphones has a microphone called a reference microphone, has a DSP processor, has an anti-noise speaker, okay? And what it does is, this reference microphone hears the sound, the disturbing sound in the ambient sound, forwards it to the DSP. The DSP gives it to the anti-noise speaker by compute. The DSP computes the anti-noise and then gives it to the speaker, and the speaker plays the anti-noise. And the hope is the sound that is coming to your ear and this anti-noise sound, these two should cancel each other. That's the hope. Make sense? But, so if this is the noise, this is the anti-noise, if the anti-noise is very well designed, they should cancel and you should hear good silence. But hey, the DSP has no way of knowing whether it's canceling well or not. right? How does the DSP is creating some anti-noise signal, and it doesn't know if it's doing a good job, right? So what these headphones also have is a feedback microphone, which listens to the sum of these two, and then tells the DSP, you know what, your cancellation is not good. Change something. The DSP changes, and again plays it. The feedback microphone says, getting better, keep changing in the right direction. It's actually a gradient descent. Keep changing in the right direction. And eventually, the DSP figures out what to do on that noise so that the anti-noise and the actual noise cancel each other nicely, and the feedback microphone says, thumbs up. Right? That's when the DSP stops doing anything. Again, if this noise source changes, moves, then again, that whole convergence has to happen. That is what is exactly happening inside your noise cancellation headphones. Okay? How do they perform today? This is what today's noise cancellation headphones do. Well, if you look at what the noise cancellation graph looks like, it turns out that noise cancellation is only viable up till 1 kilohertz. What? All these signals that are coming from 1 to 10 kilohertz, the cancellation only happens till 1 kilohertz. And the rest, actually, there's hardly any cancellation. So then how come we hear pretty good silence with these devices? Anyone? The blocking material. Bose has actually invested a lot of research on materials. And this blocking material is the one which cancels or suppresses, it doesn't cancel, sorry, it suppresses the high frequency sounds, and together, this blocking material plus the noise cancellation device, together they give you a good experience. Which means, if you remove the blocking part, and you keep your ear open, you're only going to get this red performance, which is not satisfactory, because human being talk and music and all kinds of stuff is very much present between 1 to 4 kilohertz. Make sense? Good. So if you look at why these headphones are not being able to do higher frequency cancellation, here is the reason. The noise is coming. Let's say the time is flowing in the vertically downward direction. Okay? The noise is coming. It hits the reference microphone, then the DSP, then the speaker, and then goes to the ear. Is this clear? Noise is coming, and this is time, downwards. It hits the reference microphone first. So the reference microphone has this noise at time t1. And when does it need to produce the anti-noise sound? What time? It has to produce the anti-noise sound by at least time t2. Make sense? Because if it produces later than T2, then the anti-noise and the noise are not going to be going out together or not going to be simultaneous, right? So which means the DSP has this much time, T2 minus T1, this much time to produce the anti-noise signal, which is a very short time, 30 microseconds, right? This is why it's not easy to do. And therefore, these things get delayed after T2. These things incur a delay, and the anti-noise actually plays a little bit later. Well, this little bit later thing is not too bad for lower frequencies. Why? If in lower frequency, this blue is the noise and red is the anti-noise, if it's a little bit later, you can see that for low frequencies, if you move the anti-noise a little bit later, it's not too bad. But for high frequencies, if you move it a little bit, it's out of phase. That's why you cannot do high frequency cancellation in these kind of headphones. Okay? So if it's a little bit off, the error actually becomes much larger, and that is why you have to rely on noise absorbing material to cancel it. Good. Let's look at what we are doing. What we are essentially doing is taking this reference microphone and moving it closer to the noise source, which means what? T2 minus T1 is the time that the DSP has to produce the anti-noise signal. That's a lot of time, right? In fact, milliseconds. And in that time, I can produce the anti-noise exactly at the time when the actual noise is passing through the speaker, and thereby I'll cancel all frequencies much better. 5 minutes, okay. Okay, so that's what I do. And that's the one of the main gains that you have enough time to actually cancel high frequency sounds. Okay? If you get into a little more signal processing, it turns out that this DSP has to estimate, so this DSP has to produce a signal which is opposite of this sound. Okay? So what is that signal? So imagine the signal comes to your reference microphone, which is the source signal, a function of the source signal, f of x, x being the source signal. What comes to the reference microphones is f of x. What comes to the feedback microphone is g of x. X is the source signal, the disturbing noise, right? What does the DSP need to do? The DSP needs to do something to this f so that it becomes minus g of x. Make sense? Right? So what is that? Essentially, that is, I need to multiply, the DSP needs to multiply minus of F inverse times G. If I multiply this or convolve this with this, minus of F inverse and F inverse will give minus X. And G of minus X is minus G of X, that these two will cancel. Make sense? So the DSP essentially estimates what is minus F inverse convolved with G. But these inverse filter estimation is actually problematic. And all I can tell you without going into the details is that for inverse filter estimation, you need future data. Forget why for now, if you're not familiar with this. But today's headphones don't have this future data, so the anti-noise that they produce is not good enough, is reasonable. But if you have future data, then you can precisely compute the anti-noise. And that's a more fundamental gain because you are actually gaining in the signal processing algorithm because mute is giving you future data by sending it over wireless. Okay? That's the big gain over here. And finally, there's also a sound profiling gain where there are two people talking. And if you know, suppose Alice and Bob are talking and your headphone is first converging to Alice, converging, canceling Alice's voice, and then once Bob starts talking, it has to say, no, this is not going to work. Let me reconverge to Bob's voice or Bob's sound, right? And it's constantly doing this back and forth. And every time the switch happens, the system has to reconverge. So the error becomes down, goes down when Alice is talking. Once Bob starts talking, the error goes up and again goes down. But if you know when the switch is going to happen, you can say, oh, Alice says, soon Bob is going to start talking, let me load the filter for Bob. So once Bob's sound comes, I'm ready to cancel it. Right? So you can actually do much better in these voice cancellation, again, because you have a future look ahead into what is happening, or into what is going to happen. Okay, great. So I want to skip some of these. And in the implementation, we have built this whole system. It's a complicated system, but this whole thing should look like this. We don't have that real system built, but it should look like this. And when we compared these two, this is what the result looks like. This is mute. The red line is our system. This is Bose. Bose does slightly better, right, than us, but we are hollow. We don't have to cover the ear. And then we said, okay, if mute, our system could also block the ear, how much cancellation gain do we get? And this is what it is. We get around 8 dB on average of cancellation better than Bose, which is this green dashed line. Okay. Maybe I should skip this stuff. There were architectural implications of this. I can talk to you offline. But the high level takeaway is that wireless can become a control plane for an acoustic data plane, and you can enable all kinds of applications. One could be acoustic augmented reality, where you walk in the downtown of Champaign-Urbana, which is not very exciting, but you hear acoustic augmented reality where you hear things as if it's Paris. Okay? You can do these kind of things in real time because you have this look ahead. The last two slides, one slide thing project that I want to talk to you is about communicating through vibration. All your devices have a vibration motor in it, right? That makes your device buzz and that gives you a tactile notification. We've designed a radio on vibration, meaning Suppose you wear this watch. We can program this vibration motor, implement a Wi-Fi-like radio on vibration motor so that data can pass through your finger bone. Right? It's like this vibration motor is sending signals, vibrations, and that is passing through your finger bone. So whatever you touch, you can communicate to that object. So what do you touch? Well, if you touch a device which has an accelerometer or which has a microphone which responds to vibration, I can now start sending data to that device. For example, I want to do Apple Pay or mobile payment, and I have my credit card on my watch. I don't have to pull out my phone and touch. I'll just touch my finger, and my credit card information will flow through my bone. You're not going to feel a thing, right? But the information will flow, and the accelerometer or the microphone will sense this vibration and decode the information out of it. Okay? We've been able to design this system, essentially a OFDM, which runs in Wi-Fi, runs on our vibration motors, and we can get around 8 kilobits per second from your watch to your fingertip. Okay? And here is a demo of it, where my student is wearing this ring, which has a vibration motor. And this ring, this vibration motor, has a picture of the Illinois logo. And there is an accelerometer on this laptop that's connected. And he's going to touch the accelerometer, and the picture is going to get transferred to the laptop. And I wanted to see how much time it takes. And I also wanted to see what the picture quality looks like after that transmission. Okay? Doesn't matter. He touches it, and the picture gets transferred in a very short time, milliseconds. And this is the quality of the picture. There are some bit errors. Not every bit goes through precisely, but it's reasonably good. It's around 8 kbps. Okay? So now you can start doing various things. And one cool thing is you wear these vibration devices, and you go to a conference. Whoever you shake hands with, you exchange business cards. Okay? I don't know if that's the most compelling application, but whenever I say, people get excited about that. Okay. Anyway, that's all I really have to say. My last slide is about acknowledging my group and most of the good stuff they do. Things where things fail, that's where I come in. But I really am very excited and I'm very grateful to have a wonderful group. And also, Haitham Hassani is one of my another member who we have formed a group together. And we are very excited in doing these kind of algorithmic things for mobile sensing and wireless. Let me stop with that, and thanks for paying attention for so long. I'll take questions.